open our Bibles this morning to the book of Daniel, and I have want to read just the first 15 verses or so, but I want to read all of this, and this talks about a condition that occurred that Daniel recognized some things that were going on. And when we look at this, when we look at this story of Daniel, in Daniel chapter 9 we're reading, and we see that the condition of the nation of Israel, that they, remember, were brought out of Egypt by the Lord God at the hand of Moses. Moses brought them out, and God was directing Moses as to how to bring these people out, and finally brought them into the land. They built a city called Jerusalem, and they lived there. They had great power and authority in the land, and then little by little, they began to play the fiddle. And what I mean by that is that they began to turn away from the things of God. And we're going to read how Daniel describes this downfall, or the fall of Israel, the fall of the Israelite people, and what was the results of that. I mean, we have the story of many great nations and great places that rose up to great fame and fortune and so on, and then something happened and brought them down. Who can forget the story of the rise and fall of the Roman Empire? This great empire also had had a great past for hundreds and hundreds of years, the great Roman Empire, and then finally it went downhill into oblivion. What happened to that country? What happened to Israel? What is happening to America? What is happening to us as individuals who happen to live in America? All of these things come into play. Now, I remember reading in my history book about the occurrence of the coming to America, you know, and how the pilgrims came over here. And the pilgrims came to America. They were seeking a pristine place where they could worship God and not be clumbered by politics of Europe and the circumstance of Europe. So they came to this country and they set up their little cities, their little towns, and they began to worship God. But you know what? Little by little, America, which was founded upon great Christian principles and upon the things that we have today, what happened to them? Little by little, we see that they also fell. Well, I'm going to read a little bit here. And you know that if you read a scripture, if you read something from God's word only as history, and you're not able to get anything out of it, if you can't apply it to your own life, to the life of your family, to the life of the nation, to the life of those around us, then I think we're missing the point of this thing. Now, there are, in fact, in the world, there are many people who claim to know God and claim to worship a God. They do worship a God. But do they worship the God, Jehovah, the God who is the friend of Abraham, who is the God of Jacob and Isaac, who is the God of Moses, who is the God of Daniel? Do they worship that God, or do they worship some other God? Well, God requires of us. God has great requirements, and he will not stand for this unrighteous, unworthy sin in our life. If we continue in a life of sin, we continue with sin, and we don't do something about it, we cannot have any relationship with the God of Moses, with the God of Abraham, with the God of Jacob or of Daniel. We can't have anything to do with them, that God. So let's read here. And in the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the numbers of years whereof the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And I prayed unto the Lord my God, and I made my confession, and I said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and the mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments, we have sinned and have committed iniquity and have done wickedly and have rebelled even by departing from thy precepts and from thy judgments. Let's stop there for a moment and let's look at reflecting upon Daniel's circumstances. And Daniel was many, many years a prisoner, so to speak, although he wasn't kept in chains. He was a prisoner of the Chaldeans, of those Babylonians. And along came the Medes or the Persians, which is modern Iran. And Iran and Iraq have been at war on and off all through the centuries. They're always at war, you know, those people. And so what had happened was that the Persians, these Medes, had come and taken the land, and they became, Darius became the king over the land. And here's Daniel now under the kingdomship of Darius, and he begins to study the books and study Jeremiah the prophet, and he studies these things, and it came to him, and it was revealed to him the numbers of years whereby the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. So in other words, that Jeremiah was told that Jerusalem would be ransacked and desolate for 70 years. And so Daniel figures this out. Here we're approaching 70 years. We're approaching the end of this time. And so the Lord has destroyed Jerusalem. The Lord caused this to happen. And we're going to read why. We're going to read what happened. And so Daniel, he sets his face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer. Now he's going to begin to pray. This is important for us to understand. Sometimes, and even in my past, I said, well, hey, I'm going to pray for me. You pray for you. But the Lord wants us to pray for others, okay? The Lord wants us to pray for others. And the Lord cares about us praying for other people. There are many sins that we cannot ask. We can ask God, well, God, the sins of my family, the sins of my nation, how can we overcome those sins? What can we do about it? I think the first thing and the most important thing is the recognition in our lives that there is sin in our lives. Once we recognize that in our own life, we say, okay, there is sin. There is sin, and I've got to address this sin. So here we find Daniel beginning to address the sin of Israel, the sin of his people, and even his own. He says, I prayed unto the Lord my God, and made my confession, and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping covenants and mercy to them that love him, and to them that keep his commandments. We have sinned. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. We have rebelled even by departing from thy precepts and from thy judgments. Now verse 6, neither have we hearkened unto thy servants the prophets which spake in thy name to our kings, to our princes, to our fathers, and to all the people of the land. In other words, we have been negligent in listening to the prophets, the warnings of the prophets, the warnings of the people of God. We've been negligent in that. We have not listened. We have turned our ear away from those things. Verse 7, O Lord, righteousness belongeth to thee, but unto us confusion of faces, as in this day to the men of Judah, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and unto all Israel that are near and that are far off, through all the countries whither thou hast driven them, because their trespass, that they have trespassed against thee. Now, you know, I think about this word trespass. You know, I live out here in the sticks, so to speak, in the country, and you're driving down the road and you see these trees, and there'll be these signs put on the tree, no trespassing. That means that the owner of that land has put a sign up, he don't want you walking around on his land. He don't want you there, trespassing. And when you trespass, you are breaking the law. You're breaking the law. So if you're breaking the law, what happens? Boy, you get in trouble with the law over being on somebody else's property. So you see the sign, you don't trespass. So look at this. Here is the Lord, Daniel saying to the Lord, they have trespassed against thee. They have broken the law against thee. O Lord, to us belongeth confusion of faces, to our kings, to our princes, to our fathers, because we have sinned against thee. To the Lord our God belongeth mercies and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him. Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws, which he has set before us by his servants, the prophets. We've gone astray. We've forgotten about the things of God. Yea, all Israel has trespassed thy law, even by departing, that they might not obey the voice. Therefore the curse is poured upon us, and the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, because we have sinned against him. And he hath confirmed his words, which he spake against us, and against our judges, and that judged us, by bringing upon us the great evil. For under the whole heaven hath not been done, as hath been done to Jerusalem. Now verse 13, as it is written in the law of Moses, all this evil is come upon us, yea, yet made we not our prayer before the Lord our God, that we might turn from our iniquity and understand thy truth. So here is Daniel. He's trying to put this puzzle together. Here I am, a captive for years and years in a foreign land, but more importantly, my city, Jerusalem, has been desolate, and nobody could live there. The foxes live in Jerusalem. It's been destroyed. Remember, we read earlier how that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, had gone to Jerusalem, and he went and sacked the city and took everything out of the temple and destroyed the city and brought everything back to Babylon. And we wonder, well, how could God allow such a thing to happen? Well, it is within the promises of God and the great blessings of God that if you don't serve him and you begin to turn away from him, that all the blessings turn into curses. And I would call them a royal curse or a holy curse against people. And it's holy because it comes from God. And if you don't serve God, you're certainly going to fall into these problems. And I look at America, this great nation, you know, we have a so-called president of the United States who said, this is not a Christian nation anymore. He's right. He was right. He says, then he goes further and he says that the Muslims have helped to build this nation. I'd like to know what parallel universe he came from, you know, because we know that this great nation that we have was founded upon the Christian principles. And we find them over and over again. Our religious leaders and our political leaders all mentioned Jesus Christ. They all mentioned God. They mentioned the things that this great nation that God has given us. But I want to speak a little bit about the sin of omission. There is a sin of omission, and that is when we fail to fulfill the duties and responsibilities that God has placed upon us. And all of us are slack or lax in this duty. You know that you have little children and you raise them up not to know about God. We have people in America who say, well, I'm going to wait till my children reach an age of understanding and then I'm going to let them decide. Well, this is totally against the word of God and against the things of God. The Bible says to train up a child in the way that he will go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. It is our responsibility, it is our duty before God to raise our young ones up to know the Lord. Teach them to pray. Teach them about Jesus. Teach them about these things. We teach them about everything else in the world. We teach them about the Mickey Mouse, and we teach them about those things. And I don't know, there's no future in that. There's nothing there. I go to the mall or I go someplace and I see young people. They got this thing in their hands and they're going like this here all the time. You try to get their attention. You can't even get their attention. They trip over the steps walking around. They'll sit in the booths, and one's on this side and the other's on the other side, and they're both going like this. They're like lost in this world of something, someplace. And our whole world has been turned upside down, inside out, because of this technology that we've been able to revert our young people back to their to this situation. And it isn't just very young people. I'm talking about people in their 20s and in their 30s who are caught up in the these little games that they have on the TV. They have little games, you know, and they're like this with the game. You're talking to them, and then did you say something? What are you talking about? And you know what? It is our responsibility, before they reach that age, it is our responsibility. It is a sin of omission. We fail to raise our families up in the admonition of the Lord. And somebody said to me, well, that family was unsaved. But if we go back and we study about that family, if they were an American family, there was a time, there was a point that grandmother or great-grandmother or great-grandfather was a Christian man or a Christian woman and began to raise that family. And maybe he passed away early or she passed away, and that family just drifted off and drifted off. I know that my grandmother became saved, and she would pray for the family. I was just a young lad, and I remember my grandmother, and she would pray for the family. She loved their family, and she prayed for us. She prayed for those who were not even born yet, she would be praying for, you know? And so our families, you know, little by little, they began to drift away. And we reach some people, and we see on the TV about people who are strong abortionists, and they want abortion in America, and they want same-sex marriages in America, and they want all these things. And we wonder, how did our country stoop so low to let those things come into our country? And it is because of a sin of omission, because we allowed our young people to drift away. And this is what happens. What happens is that, you know, that we become guilty of these things. We had some great preachers in America. We had Billy Sunday. We had Billy Graham, who was a great preacher. And we have some Christian people who criticize Billy Graham. They say, oh, well, Billy Graham, you know, he believed this or he believed that. Let me tell you something. Billy Graham gave a salvation message. He talked about Jesus. He talked about the blood of the Lamb. He talked about the only way that you can get into heaven is through Jesus. And we need to hear those messages again. We need to hear that again. We need to get a firm grip on our own faith and turn it around. And we start as Daniel started here. Daniel began to blame himself and blame his people. He didn't blame God. He blamed himself. He blamed his people. He says, we are the ones who have turned away from you. We are the ones that sinned. We are the ones with the confusion of face. In other words, confusion of faith, face, meaning that their faces are not turned toward God. They're looking for something all the time, always trying to find out why things are happening in their life. We go back to, as we read here in verse 13, as it is written in the law of Moses, all this evil is come upon us. And so here we go back to Deuteronomy in chapter 28, and I want to read a few verses here from chapter 28. And verse 13, look what it says. It says, we left off with 13 in Daniel, and we'll pick it up here, 13 in Deuteronomy. It says, the Lord shall make thee head and not tail, and thou shalt be above only. And thou shalt not be beneath. if that thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day to observe to do them, thou shalt in no wise go aside from the words which I command thee this day to do to the right or to the left, or to go after other gods or to serve them. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe all the things his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. And then we have all these things that God said, that if you don't serve me, and if you don't obey my commandments, if you don't do those things that I've asked you to do, these things are going to come upon you. Cursed shall thou be in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field. Cursed shall thou thy basket and thy store. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of the land, and the increase of the kine, and of the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shall thou be when it goes out. And all of these things continue with these curses. And I want to go to the end of this here chapter, and verse 58, if thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear the glorious and fearful name, the Lord thy God, then the Lord will make the plagues wonderful, and shall plague of thy seed, even great plagues of long continuance and sore sicknesses and of long continuances. Here is this promise that God made. He told them that he brought them out of Egypt. He told them that he set them in the land. And he said, now you serve me. You belong to me. But the people turned away from God. And at the end of this chapter, verse 67, in the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even, and at even thou shalt say, would that it, God that it was morning. For the fear of in thine heart, wherefore thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thy eyes, which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee. And thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondsmen and bondswoman, and no man shall buy thee. Here is this a promise that if they didn't serve God, that they would go into captivity again, and that they would be prisoners of the nations. And this, as we know, is what happened. Now, I want to get to the meat of this a little bit, that the Bible says that we war not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in high places. And this is this war against, this spiritual war against the devil. And the devil wants to drag you down into hell. He would like to destroy you if he could. And the only thing that prevents the devil from destroying you is the Lord God, who sets a hedge against him so that he cannot destroy you. If God were to turn his back completely upon you and not look at you even, and allow himself to just occupy himself with something else, the devil would come along and destroy every one of us. The Bible says that he is a murderer from the beginning, is a liar and a thief, and he will come and destroy you if he could. And it is only the graciousness of God that we could breathe every morning when we wake up. We could say, well, the Lord God has been watching me. So we struggle against this war that against the enemy. And so the enemy, you know, he comes along sometimes like a roaring lion, and sometimes the Bible says like an angel of light, and he comes to bring confusion and hatred and different things that he can use in our lives to separate us from one another and to destroy us. Here we have this great example, and I don't know how much more God could do, what he could do to show us by taking the nation of Israel, this great nation, and this great city, Jerusalem, and allowing it to prosper for a time because they worshiped him. And then finally, what happened? Because of their disobedience, what happened? They lost everything that they had. Everything is gone. So we see this example. How can we change those things in our lives? And how can we turn this great nation around? We've got to stand firm in the Word. But we have got to recognize sin. And we've got to ask the Lord to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our sins, Lord. Wash us and cleanse us with your precious blood. The Bible says that God is faithful and just to forgive us, and that he will wash us with his blood, and he will cleanse us. You see, that God really, truly loves us. And the Bible says that God so loved us that he gave his only son, Jesus, that we might have eternal life. Well, how did he do that? He sent Jesus into this world. He sent him in that he might not risk his life, but give his life. And so Jesus gave his life. He gave his life at Calvary. They crucified him. They whipped him. They beat him. Put a crown of thorns upon his head. And God allowed this to happen to vindicate you and me because of sin. We've been justified by the blood of Jesus Christ, and so that we can have this relationship with him. But the relationship is broken. Even though Christ died and shed his blood, the relationship is broken. Why is it broken? It is broken because we refuse to acknowledge the sin in our life. We refuse to turn to him. We refuse to teach our children the things of God. We refuse to listen to the voice of those who are preaching his word and warning us how we should live a good and Christian life. I'm back in Daniel in chapter 14. Therefore hath the Lord watched upon the evil and brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all his works which he hath done, for we obeyed not his voice. Now, O Lord our God, thou hast brought thy people forth out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, and hast gotten thine renown as at this day. We have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thy anger and thy fury be turned away from thy city, Jerusalem, thy holy mountain, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and thy people are become a reproach to all that are about us. I would recommend this verse 16, that we pray it, that we pray this verse, not just for using the word Jerusalem, but America. Lord, America. Now I'm going to read it again. Listen to this. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let not thy anger and thy fury be turned away from thy country, America. Thy holy mountain, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our father, America, and the people are become a reproach to all that are about us. We're hated throughout the world. We should be loved. We contribute so much money, billions of dollars to other nations, and yet, even though we give that money to them, they hate us. They hate what we stand for. You know why? Because we're two-faced. We say one thing and we do something else. We say that we care about people, but we care more about ourselves. I'm talking about us as individuals also. Now, 17, therefore, O our God, hear thy prayer of thy servant and his supplication, and cause thy face to shine upon the sanctuary that is desolate for the Lord's sake. America is in big trouble. America is at the brink of going over the deep end, of becoming a nation, a godless nation, just like other nations. We become a godless nation. We have nothing. We cannot call upon God anymore. We cannot say, well, God is we believe in God. We stand upon God. And America, for the longest time now, there's so many people in America who just don't want to hear about the things of God. Why? Because they were brought up without hearing the things of God. They were brought up in a time when people were too busy taking care of their own things and not training up their children, not watching over their children. And this is what's happening to our great country. We are approaching the end of the age. And we heard a preacher the other day speak of the pale horse, a pale horse, and the rider on that horse is death. And we see in our country, and we see throughout the world, the stage is set for a great war. And the war that we see with our physical eyes is a, we call it World War III maybe. But the great war is the war that we have against this devil. And this war is taking place in this country. And we're letting the devil win the war because we have turned away from God. Remember God. Turn back to Him. Ask Him to forgive your sins. Ask Him to wash you and cleanse you. And begin to lead a life with God in control of your life. Watching what you do. Watching what you say. Watching where you go. Watching what you're thinking about. Watching your children, your young people in America today. And this goes out not only for the ones in this room, but especially those watching by TV. You're responsible for your family. You're responsible for your children. This is what Daniel's saying. Daniel is saying, my nation has sinned. Forgive my nation. He wanted to intercede for his nation. And we need to intercede for our families and for our friends. Go before God and say, Lord, they have sinned a great sin. Lord, what can we do? How can we bring a message to them that they need forgiveness? Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, this day. We thank you for the blessings, Lord, of your precious word, Lord. This revelation of Daniel, Lord, of recognizing why these things have happened to his nation, that we might see why the things that are happening to our nation, they're not happening because other nations are more powerful than us. They're happening because we have turned away from you and we have allowed these things to happen. Lord, speak to our hearts, Lord. Remember America. Remember our great nation, Lord, and how it was founded on the belief that you are the living God and that your son Jesus is the salvation, the only salvation to mankind. And Lord, that your Holy Spirit, Lord, comes and has dwelt with many in this country. And Lord, has been a leader and a guider, Lord, toward the things of God. And Lord, we ask, Lord, that people's hearts would be changed, Lord, that they would be a revival, Lord, of the things of God in our lives, we pray. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God.
The lily
amen.
Of the valley. Jesus is described here as the lily of the valley. Praise the Lord.
Oh. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest. thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine, with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Lord, unto me. Oh, what he's done for me. Oh, what he's done for me. Oh, what he's done for me. I never shall forget what he's done for me. Saved my soul and he made me whole. That's what he's done for me.
I know the Lord is good. He always told me that he would hear of all my need and strengthen me. So I trust him, yes I do. In this pilgrim land he's true. Jesus, yes Jesus rescued me. He rescued me from troubled water. He rescued me and now I'm free. He rescued me, and I do love him. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescued me. If you're troubled in this land and can't find a helping hand, call on Jesus, he will hear you when you call. Never fear the storm or dark, 'cause you're riding in God's ark. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescues all. He rescued me from troubled water. He rescued me and now I'm free. He rescued me and I do love him. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescued me. Now when trouble comes my way, I call on Jesus and I say, Jesus, fill my heart and set me free. With that Holy Spirit blast, from my being fear is cast. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescues me. He rescues me from troubled waters. He rescued me, and now I'm free. He rescued me, and I do love him. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescues me. Jesus, yes, Jesus rescues me.
Jesus is the only way. He's the only name you'll hear on that day. What price will you bring when you stand before the King? Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way. And he walked upon the water one sweet day. He healed the blind and lame. All glory to his name. Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way. He's the truth and the life, I'm here to say. He gave his life for me on the cross of Calvary. Jesus is the only way.
He's the only way, folks.